Welcome to We Have a Voice Radio. My name is Kevin Jess, and I'll be your host today. We are broadcasting through iHeartRadio, Spreaker, YouTube, and other networks. Today, we have on our show Leah Mattinson. She has been on our show before, and we had promised to do a follow-up, and one thing led to another, and that hadn't happened, but today it's happening. And so she is going to be talking about moving beyond body limits and the quickest way to wellness. So, Leah, how are you today?
Hey, Kevin, I'm fantastic. How are you?
Oh, just tickety-boo.
Tickety-boo. Yeah.
So,
Well, sounds like you've already moved beyond all your limits and you're already well. So, interview over. Thank you all for joining us. It's been fabulous.
You know, no, I'm far beyond well. I haven't aged well, so I'm a fat man now. I can't stand too much excitement. You know, my heart might go. So,
but age anyway, like a fine wine.
Oh yeah. But I might as well laugh about it, right? So,
absolutely.
Anyway, yeah. You, like I say, you've been on the show before, and of course I know that you have your own show, that you operate like 6 days a week that you're on the air, and so maybe you should tell our audience who may not remember or didn't tune into the last episode that you were on, just tell a little bit about yourself, and then we can move on to the subject.
Sure, fantastic. Yeah, I have a radio show on UK Health Radio right now called Master Your Life. We were on Voice America and decided to go with UK Health because they have a health focus, so it made more sense for our audience. When I say our, the co-host of my show is Dr. Howard Rankin, and so he and I talk a lot about different ways to master your life, primarily in the area of health and wellness. We also cover relationships and the dynamics around helping people who are going through, you know, all kinds of life changes. So support groups, that type of work. So he and I have been in partnership doing that kind of work for about 3 years now. And prior to that, I've been I'm a counselor by trade with a youth specialization and have owned multiple businesses in terms of being in the Huntington's disease community. My family has Huntington's disease in the family. My dad has HD. He's 80, still living at home, in great shape, still magnificently functioning in terms of being able to participate in things in the home. So he still helps with meal preparation, you know, taking out the garbage, snow removal, because we live in Canada, so that is a must. If you can't remove snow, you're not getting out of your house. And he and his brothers still get together regularly, his older brothers, you know. So dad's 80, his older brothers are 87 and 90. And they don't have Huntington's, but they still socialize, right? So they're out in the community just this week. They're, you know, out for dinner celebrating just the fact that they're still alive and functioning and doing well. And their spouses are all still alive. And so my parents have been married for 54 years. And my mom they rely on each other to have a great life. So in spite of or because of the Huntington's, I've been raised in this really cool environment where, you know, we just really appreciate every day. We appreciate my dad's wellness. He's also not on any medications of any kind. He's articulate. He can think about politics and health and prays for people regularly. Regularly meaning 2 or 3 times a day, that they're doing well and that the world is experiencing more peace. So I just think that he's been a really great example of the other way that you can live, or another way that you can live with disease of any kind, in optimal wellness. Yeah, so he goes out in the community, plays cards. They have friends in the community. He's still making friends at 80. And his movement disorder is quite significant now. So he looks like he's drunk all the time. But he doesn't care. And most other people, you know, really don't seem to care either. So he still goes out. And like I say, still making friends. And that at that age, I think, is incredible in and of itself, because a lot of people just shut themselves off to life experience when they experience any kind of health change, and he just hasn't done that. Yeah, so that's kind of my, and then I'm gene positive for Huntington's. I have two children, one who has been tested, one who has not. And my child who's been tested is gene positive, and so I have two grandchildren that are at risk.
Wow, okay. Yeah. So, you mentioned something, about your dad there, and and you see this with a lot of people. When they have something to look forward to, when there's a plan, when there's something, they seem to blossom a lot more than, say, someone who shuts themselves in. And I see that a lot. And even with my wife, who's in a nursing home now, with she has Huntington's disease, and even though I'll say, okay, I'll go in and say, well, you have a hair appointment on Wednesday, which she does this week. So she's looking forward to that hair appointment, right? Now, she's nonverbal. I mean, she can speak a little bit, very little. I can understand what she's saying, right? But most people can't. But I think that has a, because her eyes will light up. You can see that there's good, something's good going through her body by having something to look forward to, that life is still going on, and so on. And so it sounds like your dad always has something to look forward to, whether it's having a social time with his wife or his brothers or whomever. And that's great, and even like my son, who is going through the process of testing now, it's he's like, no, it doesn't, I'm not afraid of it. I'm not gonna fret about this. I'm not upset about it. I'm not, there's none of that. He says it just gives me, the only thing that's gonna do for me is it's going to maybe give me a kick in the butt or something like that to go move on, and make plans and fulfill things that maybe he might put off, and that type of thing, if that makes sense to you.
Yeah, and I think that's really interesting that everyone's families make different decisions around how they, or each person individually, I guess, makes decisions about how they either do or don't do the testing. I did the testing because I wanted to know because of exactly that. I wanted to have a plan. I was going through kind of a not great divorce and went, well, it's like this might either make me more tenacious about how I'm going to see out the end of my, seek the end of this resolution of this thing. And in fact, it was the opposite. I actually just came into way more peace about everything because I went, stress is completely not worth it for. There's so much evidence now that when we live in a stress-free, created of our own minds, a stress-free environment that we lead, it leads us to more wellness. So that was more my experience with the testing. When my daughter went 10 years later, and so she was 18, and she said to me when she got her test results back, she hugged me and she was in tears for less than 5 minutes. And she said, Mom, I just am really happy that you're my mom because I couldn't imagine learning how to be well from anyone better.
Yes.
Which I took as the hugest compliment
Oh,
because
what?
it, you can be well. So when I've watched my dad go through this, for the past, he got his status at 53. I'll call it status, right?
Yeah,
So
okay.
he was diagnosed when he got his status when he was 53. But we had watched my grandmother go through this, and she was paranoid. She had features of that at the end of her life. She died in the Alberta hospital, which would have been considered the mental hospital at that time. And now that's now called, like the brain injury clinic. So everything has softened up a little bit around the whole idea of mental health and mental wellness as well. But when Dad got his genetic status, I mean, he, or his, sorry, his diagnosis, he had already been quote unquote symptomatic for probably 25 years. But when I look at him in terms of the general population of people, he was way less symptomatic of stuff than people I know who have no disease at all. Like, I know a lot of people who are mentally ill, lots, a lot of people who are on medications. I know a lot of people who can't function in a job. They can't find employment. They can't get along with other people. They don't have impulse control. They don't like all of that stuff. And they don't have Huntington's. So it's an interesting look back over a span of time where he really was well and is well because of this whole focus around, well, what's next in my life? What's next in my life? What, and he doesn't get hung up a whole lot in the past, right? He remembers, he has a great memory, and he does have a great memory when people wait for him to retrieve the memory. Yes. And let him talk about it. He can remember things from when he was a very little boy and completely accurately. So it's a, he has a fantastic memory.
Well, you know, I remember a teacher telling me one time when I was a kid, I've never forgotten it. And and a lot of us, you know, we forget. I know a lot of people, they forget things that happened in their childhood. They even, like, they'll walk by you in the street because they don't remember you, that you were in their class in school. They don't, you know, and things like that. And I know who they are. Like, you know, why do you, are they having such a time recalling me? But apparently it's not that big of a deal to not remember. But he said, when you get older, as you get older, the memories of your youth tend to come back. So you when you hear a lot of seniors sitting and talking there and reminiscing, it's so interesting to listen to that, and but they're remembering probably a lot of things that they had previously forgotten, and so they say you want to make your youth really good, because if it's bad, all these bad memories could flood back to you, you know. So you got to make some good memories. I think you should throughout your life anyway, obviously. But it might be really important. We just don't realize that when we're young. But nevertheless,
yeah.
So moving beyond body limits. So what do you mean by that?
Well, I think that in the Huntington's community, and so I'll just say that my business has been, I've been a coach for 30 years now. So I've been an executive coach, a personal coach, a life coach, a trainer at the gym, a nutritional coach. So I've wore a lot of coaching hats. And in coaching people towards wellness, I see and have experienced myself some, you know, body function that changes over the span of time, and a lot of times through injury. And sometimes the injury is things that we don't know that we're even doing to ourselves. So injury can be if somebody takes a stick to the head in hockey, you know, and they're not wearing a lid. It's like, oh, damn, now I have a head injury. Yes, you do. Welcome to the world of concussion. So that's one. But overtraining can be another one, where you will just simply go and do too many box jumps at the gym, and all of a sudden you've got a torn hamstring. You know, people don't look at those injuries as lifelong necessarily. They'll look and go, okay, over a span of time, we can heal those things, fix those things, repair those things, work around those things. But when we're in this, you know, the world of Huntington's disease, people have this belief that their body is going to change and betray them. And it's not just their body, it's their physical health, their mental health, their brain function because of cognitive decline or cognitive distress. And we strum on that vibration so loudly over and over again. And I'm sure you've heard this, you get what you expect.
Yes. Right?
Everyone's heard that. So when you expect that you're going to have a body and brain that betrays you, guess what you get?
Yeah.
A body and brain that betrays you. And so by learning how to actually strum on a different chord of allowing in wellness, we can move beyond these body limits, just like professional athletes do.
Yes.
And I always use the term professional athletes because most people can recognize or think about a time when a professional athlete that they knew or they've heard about a great story where they got injured and they overcame it. And we all go, wow, that was completely exceptional, right?
Yes.
But it really isn't completely exceptional. It really happens all the time. They just understand, and they've been trained and coached. That, yeah, sometimes you take a little bit of a kick to the shins or whatever it is.
Yes.
But your body wants to be well all the time. Your body is moving towards wellness.
Yes. Now,
yeah, so that's,
to give
that's
you a little
big
story,
idea, right?
Well, yeah, well, I can sort of identify a little bit with that because you know what Acadia University is.
Right? Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Well, there's a young woman who here not too long ago, she had a stroke. She was a student at Acadia University. and it's been in the news lately. And I mean, the stroke was so bad. I mean, she had to relearn her ABCs. I mean, we got back to that. But she's back at school, and she's going to be a nutritionist, I think it is. And she's got that all back now. She had to relearn everything. But so her mind, inside, okay, so maybe there were limits to what she could do, but she moved beyond that. You know, and I think that's what you're saying, is she has in her mind, she is, this is not what is going to happen for me. What is going to happen for me is this. And then she did that. So
yeah, that and you absolutely nailed it, Kevin.
Yeah,
that is absolutely spot on. And that you describe really succinctly what the conversation is that happens in a person's head when they decide that they're going to move beyond that limit, is that they've got the contrast of illness to go, hey, that sickness is what is making me want to be well.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's it.
To have magnificent wellness, not just sort of.
Yeah. Now, how would you apply it to this? Okay. When my wife was first getting sick, okay, I could see the symptoms. I could see all this. She had anosognosia, so she was not in denial, but she just didn't see them. She didn't see these symptoms. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know if in that particular case how this would have worked. Now, mind you, she was a fitness freak. She was every day, you know, she'd be out in the backyard with the dog, and she'd be carrying these two weights and running back and forth in the yard every day. Her diet, all her life, she had a very wide variety, you know, in her diet, and she loved everything. And but when it came, she didn't want to talk about Huntington's disease. She never wanted it mentioned, okay? Now, I could never really understand that, because I felt that knowing would be better than not. And she didn't. She just didn't. She wanted to be completely in denial of some, you know, and keep her mind positive. I don't know if it did any good, to, you know, to be honest. I'm just, you know, we're having a discussion. I just don't know if it did. Would things have happened sooner if she hadn't have kept that? Or would, you know, I just don't think that she was in a healthy place in the mind, where I think that you know, moving beyond those limits, moving beyond those body limits, if she had known what was going on with her, she might have been able to move beyond those body limits. Maybe acceptance.
Well, and I think you bring up, so I think you bring up a really interesting point, and something for people to contemplate is that the person who's going through whatever the situation is. So if she was going through some sort of brain dysfunction or change, and then you as the caretaker want to strum on the illness more and more and more, does that lead the person who's experiencing the change to actually be more well? And all evidence scientifically is to the contrary of that, is that when we bring a light to things, it actually raises the vibration of that thing. So often we see this in groups that are waging the war against something, and they're fighting against something, and they're fighting against disease, and they're fighting against war, and they're fighting against cancer, and they're fighting against HD. And all that does is brings up this big vibration of fighting. And you can't allow peace into that vibration. Peace doesn't exist. And one thing that we know is a body that's at ease and a mind that's at ease and a mind that's at peace and content with itself. And so it's all of this very much turning the thinking on its head about being at war with all of this stuff and fighting against it, fighting against the thing that's happening, versus exactly what your wife was doing by the sounds of it, which is embracing peace, embracing wellness, embracing that your inner source knows how to bring you to the most wellness that it can possibly experience. But what I will say about that as well, though, is that many people will get evidence that they're not doing so hot. And instead of actually embracing that evidence and doing something differently, they'll continue to do what it is that they've been doing forever. So I'll give you an example that's not in the Huntington's world, just to sort of clear that up a little bit. There's been some evidence that there's quite a bit of evidence to support that a ketogenic nutrition plan helps with all kinds of neurological things and helps with weight loss. So it'll also help with getting rid of type 2 diabetes if you actually follow a ketogenic meal plan. So many of my clients come to me and say, oh, yes, like I just want to do this keto thing and it's going to be the thing that fixes everything in my life. And, you know, I'm an amen, sister, blah, blah, right?
Yeah.
And I go, awesome, right? Awesome, great. That's, I'm glad that you've done, awesome. It's like, awesome, okay, then what do I need to do to be in ketosis? What do I need to do to make that? What does they need to do? And they go, oh yeah, awesome. I'm totally going to do all that. And they do it for about 3 days. And then they go, you know, I don't actually love this much. This is a lot of work. And it's a lot of like, I don't think this is the drum that I want to beat. So even today, I had a client this morning who it's like their bleeding neck problem is that their spouse said to them that they were putting on a little bit of weight. And they were really hurt by this. So they wanted to know about the keto thing. And I'm saying, okay, well, this is what you need to do. So they're week three into it. So just starting into week three. So they've been 14 days. In the first 14 days, they had at least 7 days where they were drinking wine. All right. So drinking wine is not ketogenic. So it's like, then we negotiate. Well, what can I get away with? What I can't get away with? So I say, live your life, like have a good time, like decide what it is you want to do. Okay, no. I really want to do this keto thing. Okay, well, here's what you need to do. So then this morning, it's like the brother is headed off to the store to buy groceries for them. And he says, well, I'm going to go pick up. I have to go back because I have to pick up jam. I said, oh, who's eating jam? And he said, like my sister. I'm like, well, how could she be eating jam? Isn't she doing the keto thing? Like, I just talked to her 2 days ago. He goes, it's sugar-free jam. I'm like, sugar-free jam is not jam. It's like, read it. Read it to me. So he's reading it. And he goes, well, it has this os and that os. I said, anything with an os is sugar. So that's not on the keto plan. So honestly, eat the jam and enjoy the living you-know-what out of it. But don't pretend that you're actually wanting to follow a plan. Like, don't do that to yourself. Right. Love your life. Live your life. Have a great time. Enjoy what you're doing. And it's like, don't make up that you're doing something that you're actually not doing, which is what people do. It's like, and then they go, I don't know why my body isn't doing that well. And we accept it all day long when people are type 2 diabetic. We look at them and go, I can totally see why you're not doing well. I can see why you have diabetes. And if you would just follow this nutrition plan, you would get yourself out of that. But we don't accept that in the Huntington's disease community or in Alzheimer's disease or in Parkinson's, right? We go, I am predestined to have this really incredibly shitty experience with disease. Instead of actually going, okay, well, if I wanted to switch things up and really not experience this, what would I do? What would I follow? What would really light me up and light my path on the way to getting there? And so that's all I'm suggesting is that we can 99% go, I really want this thing. And for the thing to not happen, because that little 1% of something is something that we just weren't really wanting to give up. We didn't really want to change it. Does it make it wrong? No. Like, that's the other thing is we want to make everybody wrong all the time too, right? It's like, so I had a couple of donuts. Now I got to be wrong about that. No, it's like, enjoy your life, live your life, have a good time, have a glass of wine if that's what you really want. Do what you want, but you're only going to be in wellness or not. And your body knows what is in wellness or isn't in wellness for it from moment to moment. Your body knows.
Oh, yes. Yes. You can go to a fast food outlet, and I love fast food, don't get me wrong, I love it, I would eat it every day, but you could, if you go and you and you basically stuff yourself or whatever. Well, if you stuff yourself with anything, you don't feel so great afterwards. But I think it's in particular when you go to some of these places because they're so high in fat and different sugars and what have you, and so you just don't feel great. So you know that what you did, that by eating all of that food has not contributed to your wellness. It does a lot for my mind. I just go, oh, that was so good, you know, and so that's why I think I love it. You know, I drink a 2 liter of Coke every day. I live like I have about the poorest lifestyle, like as far as eating habits goes. I mean, I eat a wide variety of things. Don't get me wrong. I'm not a fussy person. I like to eat really good food. But I also do other things, like say drinking a 2 liter of Coke every day or more, right? I've cut it in half. It used to be 2 2-liters of Coke. I did that for about 30 years. And of course now I'm overweight you know, what have you. But I laugh about it. I'm not upset about it. I'm quite happy, you know. And I'm just going to live what I'm going to live, right?
To contrast. Yeah, and until there's a contrast where you go, wow, I am incredibly unhappy. So if you've got, I'll just use, like, I have tons of case examples, I guess, of all of this, right? It's like, until you're really sick, for a lot of people, they don't crave wellness until they really have a contrasting illness. And then they go, holy mackerel, I do not want to be well. We're not very good storytellers in terms of creating the narrative of going, I want to be well because I want my children to experience the most magnificent mother or father they could possibly have. That's about 5% of the population that really can dial into that without having something in their hand that kicks their butt. And you use your son as a great example, right? He's going for the genetic testing. If he has a piece of paper in his hand that says your life is going to be incredibly challenging or your life could be a cakewalk, right? And he still is going to have to pay attention to his wellness. But most times people don't make decisions that are big leaps of wellness or abundance, you know, unless they've experienced lots of poverty. People don't go for, you know, the brass ring. If people have been ill, then they go for wellness. If people have been in a war, they look for peace. There's these huge contrasts in life that cause us to seek things. But if we haven't had those big contrasts, we just don't. So oftentimes caregivers don't get why people with any kind of disease all of a sudden will have this switch flipped and they'll just be at the gym and they'll be eating great food and they'll be, you know, meditating 2 or 3 times a day, is because they've had the contrasting idea of what being sick is going to look like, feel like, how it's going to hurt the kids, how it's going to hurt future generations. And they take it very personally and they go, this is not okay for me. This is not okay for my family. This is not okay for my grandkids. I don't want them to. I want them to experience somebody who has a absolute vivacious love for life. That is what is going to be our family legacy. But until you have that contrast and you really own it, which most people don't, it's like they numb out, right? Well, I'll just have a glass of wine and I'll have 10 glasses of wine and then, let the chips fall where they may. So part of the... pardon the pun, let the chips fall where they may. The kettle chips or any other chips. I should be looking for an endorsement from Old Dutch or something, right?
Yes.
Lays, hey. Exactly. But, you know, like, until you've had this really big contrast, you don't necessarily, and that you really own it and feel what it feels like. So my daughter's saying to me, it's so incredibly important, Mom, that you've been living your life in this really well state for the past 10 years, because you're the mentor I would look to help me figure this out. And same goes with my grandchildren now. They've got a grandma who at almost 51 years old can still do cartwheels, shovel, you know, tons and tons of snow. Like, I'm very, very fit.
Yes.
And I don't know that I would have been that fit if I wouldn't have had that piece of paper in my hand that said, hey, this could be your reality. Because I might not have had the fire lit under me,
Yes,
to go, this is important.
It makes you, it allows you to make better choices. For one thing, and for another, it just gives you a different state of mind. Now, yes, you can easily fall into the doldrums and just, you know, woe is me attitude. That's very easy to do. And, but to move towards a positive side where, you know, I don't know if this is the right words or not. Like, I hear some people say, I don't let Huntington's disease define me, right? And I'm not necessarily, like, I don't ascribe to that. Because I don't have Huntington's disease, and yet it kind of defines me.
Right.
Right? It really does. Because I feel, and as we talked about before, I feel like I'm in the fight of my life, you know? And I'm always the one who's fighting, where other people just want to have peace. You know? So maybe I'm the worst part of the disease, in a sense. But you know, and for a lot of people, like you say, like some, you know, this person that's on the ketogenic diet who's sending for stuff at the store that's not keto, whatever. These diets or way of life now for them, it's not that simple. It's kind of a hard thing. So a lot of us will lose interest as well in we think we want to do this, and we do. We want to get to a better place for ourselves as far as wellness goes, but we lose interest quickly. So what's the quickest way to wellness, you know? You know what I mean?
Well, I think that the quickest way to wellness is happiness. Like, so really, truly being happy in yourself and being in love with yourself, and being happy with yourself and being in love with yourself will usually include activities that move you towards more and more self-respect, move you towards better and better choices for yourself. So whether that's with relationships or in finance or in your health, that as you move towards that better refinement of yourself and better being by your metric.
Somebody is trying.
Better being by what?
Just one second.
To desperately to get through.
Just one second.
But trying to, I think, that's
just
okay.
Just one second. I've got a call coming through, and I don't even think I can shut it off. There. Hopefully that won't happen again. Maybe I should just... let me see here. There. Let's try and do that way. I'm trying to shut it off so that it doesn't interfere with the show, but I didn't realize that was going to happen. I don't even know how I can block it. But like I say, surprise. I'm new to this. All these buttons.
Caller? Yeah. Should have just taken it. Turn it into an episode of Frasier.
Could you Roz. Actually hear that?
Barely. Just a little bit of ringing. It was not bad at all.
No, because I'm not worried about it. It's just that what I'm thinking is, would I be able to accept a call on Facebook? Because I think it's only Skype that works with this. So I don't know if I can actually do that. I'll have to test it someday. But
maybe. So do you want to just pick up with the quickest way to wellness then?
Yes, I would. Sorry about that interruption.
Okay. That's okay. So I just think, so the quickest way to wellness really is happiness. And happiness is a very internal thing. So what usually moves human beings towards happiness is things that make us have incredibly high self-respect. So that can be, you know, how we look, how we feel, and not looking is not a thing that's an aesthetic thing. It's how our body physiologically shows up when we're taking really good care of this thing that we've been given, this vessel that we've been given and shown up here in, you know. And so when we're really tapped in to the things that light us up, we do things that are incredibly good for ourselves. And that is the quickest way to wellness. So there's lots of people who have plans or, you know, workout things at the gym and all this. And I've probably done them all. So because, again, I'm almost 51 and I've been involved in athletics since I was 16 years old at very high levels. Yes. And I've also been incredibly overweight. I've had other challenges in my life. So I was sexually abused as a child. I had put on 100+ pounds, and when I was 30, I lost all that. You know, so I've had some other things in my life beyond Huntington's that have absolutely defined and refined who I am. So things that I really want and things that I really do not want in my life. But without those contrasts, I wouldn't be refined to the point that I am. Yes. And always wanting to be good, better, best, never let it rest till the good is better and the better is the best, is that refinement of how we feel about ourselves. It's not about other people. It's not about their journey. It's not comparing to other people or with other people. It's how do I become the best version of me, the most shiny, the most fun, the most vibrant, the most energetic, the most vivacious? How do I become that each moment? What are the things that are bringing more of that incredible joy and love into my life? And what are the things that I choose that are not? And that is the quickest way to wellness. So if somebody says to me, "So ketogenic, not ketogenic," I go, "Is that my mom's scone?" I think I'm going to eat that, because man, she makes good scones. And so I don't, that's not ketogenic. Yes, I know. It's totally not. Breaking bread is an important, living a really healthy life, and breaking bread with other people, socializing with other people, but don't have 10 of them, Liam Attenson. Right. Like I say, don't do that. It's like one is great, and one with all of the beautiful homemade jelly that I can eat and pile on it, and it makes a big mess on the plate, and I just love every single bite. And I say to my mom, "That is the best scone ever. Oh my God, yeah. It's so good," because it really is. It's absolutely amazing. And yes, those experiences are completely different than when you go to the store, buy 10 scones, eat them by yourself because you're feeling sad. You know, like that emotional eating, it's a completely different thing. So that's one. A training is another one. It's like I've done every training you could imagine up to 45 years old. Then I started getting some injuries from overtraining. And then going, as a professional athlete, okay, you're going to be benched for a little while. So then how are you going to get back into the game? How are you going to get back in and be playful about what it is that you're going to do now? Then I broke my wrist, 4 years ago. It's like that took me out of the game for doing lots of things like squats and, carrying weights around, shoveling, normal things that I would have done that would have helped me to continue to be fit. But knowing in my mind that fitness is always available to me, I adapted my training routine to fit my life now. So now at this point, there's things that I do that I didn't do 5 years ago. You know, I do more of this incredibly difficult gymnastics basic training that's sort of also meshed with yoga. And it's a 1 hour routine that is incredibly hard and makes me feel like $1 million. I sprint, I skip. There's things that I do to stay well. I can shovel snow. And I do those things that make me happy. Do I train every day? If I want to, absolutely. If I don't feel like it, I don't. But I totally go on where my energy is at. So I don't need somebody else saying to me, "Okay, well, you need to do fill in the blank here." I can put my jeans on and I can go outside and go, "Does my body feel like it felt yesterday or better?" Answer is no. Yeah, it's then, okay, well, so what are the stories we tell ourselves about aging, even in this society? Well, by the time you're 50, you should, weigh 30 pounds and have put on 2 or 3 pounds a year, and you should have lots of problems. And as a woman who's had 2 children, you should have lots of problems, with your uterus should be falling apart by this point. You should have all of these back problems. This is normal. This is what we're told. It's hogwash. And that's what people need to understand, is we have this ability to be well, and our bodies want to be well. And the quickest way to wellness is to, first of all, hold that idea even in your mind and go, "Oh, you mean there's some different way that I could be well?" Yeah. Like I look at my dad, who's 80, and go, "Holy man, like you're well, you are well." Yeah. You go out and shovel snow with Huntington's. Yeah. It's like, is it? Yeah. It's like, good for you, man. Most people, and lots of snow.
Most people at 80, without Huntington's cannot shovel their driveway.
Exactly. And they have a huge driveway. Now, maybe that's been part of my mom's plan to keep him well. It's just have more work for him to do. Good job, Mom. Really, it's like, but understand that this is what is possible for you. And not to overdo it, but be excited about what's available to you to do. So we'll fight over the shoveling sometimes when I go to visit them because he'll go, "Don't shovel all my driveway." Like, "Mom, Dad, come on." Yeah, he says, "No, that's my work. That's my work." I'm like, "Okay, fair enough. I'll go find my own work. I'll shovel the neighbors."
You
They
know,
won't
when I feel
complain.
really well, it happens right after my haircut.
Ah.
I cut my own hair, and because I don't, well, my wife always cut my hair. Of course, now she's not able. And every
Right.
once in a while, I go into the salon there in the mall and get a haircut. But lately, I have not. I figure, well, I'm gonna save. It's only $12 to get a haircut, right? So, but still, I go, well, I can have that $12 in my pocket. And so I'll stand in front of the mirror with a pair of electric clippers, and I put a guard on it, and I just zoom all over my head, and it doesn't come out too badly. But afterwards, I feel so light and I feel so great. And and I want to do something, and whether it's go out for a beer with a friend, or whether it's bake a pie, like I just feel like I want to do
Right.
something. So I guess the trick is finding whatever it is that releases those what they call good endorphins, that get you going and make you feel happy. And the more you do that, the more you're going to accomplish, and it's going to be like a snowball effect. You're going
Yes.
to start feeling more well, doing more things, more happiness sets in, and it should continue. So you have to keep that whole thing up. So of course I only cut my hair once a month. So, but I'm not just happy once a month,
Well, that's good news. But yeah, this gets, and again, spot on, Kevin. It's like that whole momentum of things, and when you have a little something that is out of alignment, that's what I call it. It's like, okay, so I was a little bit off course. That didn't feel good to me. The beautiful thing is that we don't need to go back and kick ourselves in the butt for not, for being off course or for doing something that didn't make us feel that hot. It's nobody cares about what you just did. What we care about is what you're gonna do. So people, carry around this portfolio of crap that they've done that they need to feel bad about for their whole life instead of actually operating more like superheroes. And superhero movies are big, all the rage for a very specific reason is because people realize that being superheroic is not just for superheroes. This happens in ourselves. And that when we build momentum upon the good, the good, the good, the good, and we don't look back into what we were doing yesterday, we don't get trapped in this whole story of, my life has been hard and it's been rough and it's been tough and my family did this. And because of that, my life is, here's what it is. It's boring,
Yes, it
so
is.
stop boring yourself with that story and start talking about, what am I creating? What do I want? What's my vision? How do I take a little step towards that today? And with incredibly just building on those things, then you get momentum. Then you can easily let go of things that didn't feel so good. You just go, "That didn't feel so good. Now, this next moment, I'm going to just do something that makes me feel incredible." And you don't have to let the "that didn't feel so hot" drag on for a whole day. You can, so people go, "Well, man, I just got an incredibly bad piece of news. And now I got to, now all day, my whole day is going to be ruined because of that." I go, "Really? Why would you give an entire 24 hours of your life to feeling like garbage? You are so incredibly amazing. Do you know you don't need to feel like garbage at all? You can just say, 'Thanks, that's not for me.'
Yeah.
Move along. Like, you don't need to wallow in anything. There's, you don't get a badge of honor for feeling like garbage. You don't. No one's passing out badges for that. And so it's this idea, again, holding the context of, if I really felt incredible all the time, how well would I be? Wow, that's a mind-blowing idea. I'm going to feel awesome. this awesomeness is available to me, not just to superheroes. My body heals itself. My mind heals itself. I am incredibly well all the time. My family is incredibly well all the time. The legacy I'm building is one of incredible wellness and incredible love. And love is the quickest way to wellness. Love of ourselves is the quickest way to wellness and the way that we move beyond body limits, because we don't necessarily buy into what was happening yesterday. We just go, how do I feel about myself today? Well, I love myself enough to, if I need 10 more minutes of sleep, I'm going to sleep.
Yes.
And I'm not going to feel bad about that. I'm not going to all automatically attribute that to depression. I'm not going to label it something not awesome. It's just like, I got to stay in bed for 10 more minutes today and just snuggle in. And it was so nice. And I love the bed that I've created. And I love the space that I've created. And I love my life that I can lay in bed for 10 more minutes and get 10 more minutes sleep. And when I get out of bed, that great feeling is going to carry on all day, you know, versus the way that most people wake up, which is, well, if I stay in bed for 10 more minutes, it must mean I'm depressed. And if I'm depressed, oh my God, how am I going to deal with that all day? It snowballs into more garbage. So yes, quickest way to wellness is love, 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 love of yourself.
That sounds good. I especially like the 10 minutes more in bed.
Yeah.
So Leah, why don't you let our listeners know how they can listen to your show, for one thing?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. You can listen to the show on UK Health Radio, which is just ukhealthradio.com. And you can get a hold of me through my website, which is leahmattinson.com. So that's LEAHAMATTINSON.com. Or you can join me on any of my closed Facebook groups. So we have three groups going now, and they're all health and wellness and neurological health. So there's really no wrong way to do this. If you connect with me on Facebook, I will get you into the right group. But the three closed groups that we have going right now are Health on Command, Effortlessly Fit Wonder Women. So, you know, guys, that's probably not for you. Yeah. Effortlessly Fit Wonder Women. And then we have Look and Feel Your Best for Men Only. So if you can't remember any of those, you didn't write them down, just look me up online. You'll find me. You'll find I'm a redhead. I'm probably the only redhead you'll find that with the name Leah. And so if you need to scribble through pictures on Google, that's who I am. And but you can certainly connect with me at my website or on any of those closed Facebook groups. And the reason we do closed groups, Kevin, just so people know, is that when you come onto my page, you basically everything we post, about 1% of people see what you put on Facebook on a public page. And so what we found is we were producing a lot of really great content and nobody's seeing any of it. So we really are in the business of helping people to be well. And if you're interested in that, then come and connect with us. Health on Command is the easiest one to remember and an easy way to get to me. You can always private message me as well. In the subject line, just put anything about Huntington's or Kevin's interview, and I will be sure to reach out to you right away personally.
Awesome. Okay, so we're going to wrap it up for the day. And I'd like to thank you, Leah, for coming on. And it's always a pleasure talking to you. You know, it's always a positive thing, and everything is all light and you know. So I really would like to thank you for that. And I'd like to tell the listeners, thank you for joining us today and listening to the show, and just to know you are loved.